Next speaker is going to be Alex Stokes. He's doing research at the Ethereum Foundation, focusing on scalability and security with regards to proof of stake and the upcoming merge. Great timing this week. And he's going to be talking about block building after the merge. Welcome, Alex.
Thanks. Hey, everyone. Okay. Okay, today we'll be looking at block building after the merge. So the question, you know, immediately is, what are we even building? You know, what does this mean? And yeah, this is a nice timing because, you know, the merge is happening this week, hopefully in just a couple days. So we have the like proof of work chain that we all know and love, and that's now being fused somehow with the consensus layer. We have this new home for Ethereum and the Beacon chain. When we do this, we talk about putting the execution payloads, so the things, you know, all the transactions we just saw in the previous talk, those transactions kind of get stuffed into these Beacon blocks. We will now refer to them as execution payloads. But in particular, we're not just like grabbing the transactions, like ordering them by fee in kind of a naive way, because there's this notion of MEV. And that's what we mean when we're talking about building blocks, is like, how can we find the most MEV, make the most valuable blocks with respect to MEV, and things like this. So I'm assuming everyone knows what MEV is. Maybe you don't. At a high level, the idea is that some sequences of transactions are more valuable than others. For example, if there's an Oracle update that changes the price of, say, some asset on chain, that can trigger a bunch of liquidations on something like MakerDAO. And because of that, this person can be highly incentivized to be the transaction just after the Oracle update, because then they have exclusive access to all these liquidations, right? And the way a lot of these protocols work is that there's some sort of finder's fee, some like reward, which can be quite large for being this person to actually trigger the liquidations. So that's an example. There's like all sorts of MEV. It's actually a very like general notion, and like the more you think about it, the more sort of intricate it gets. So fun stuff. But point being is, MEV exists, and also it's a centralizing force. So the reason why is because you can sort of play all these different games, there's these different strategies. If you follow the space, you've heard of these actors called searchers, and searchers are the ones who specialize in extracting this MEV, finding these opportunities and trying to capture some of the value in them. And the thing is, if you get good at this, you can basically use your profits to get better. And now you have this flywheel that makes you better over time. It turns out this is a centralizing force for the protocol, which we don't want, right? That weakens the health of things overall. Because if you, say, have like this like specialized group of searchers who then, you know, partner with, say, the validators or some validating pool, for example, then you get this thing that just kind of all collapses. And that's not what we want. So what can we do? There's a lot of things we can do. One of them you've probably heard of, the technique we'll refer to as proposer builder separation, PBS. And basically it says, okay, like MEV is this thing, we won't be able to get rid of it, so what we're gonna do is just kind of firewall it off from everything else. There's this whole world of MEV extraction happening, and with respect to validators, with proposers in the system, they kind of are separated from it in a way that we will figure out how to do. And this is good because then it removes the centralization pressure, so then you can have validators doing their job, validating the chain like they usually do, without worrying about these, again, pressures to decentralize. It turns out, though, that like much like MEV, the more you think about PBS, it's like this huge design space. There's like so many different options and ways to think about doing it. We'll probably want to enshrine something into the core protocol, but it's not clear at all today what that looks like. So ahead of that, the question is, what can we do? And what we can do is basically do something like PBS, but just do it off-chain. And if you follow the work of Flashbots, they've been working on a solution that does exactly this called MevBoost. And I'll just kind of very briefly walk through the steps now. And really, it's just saying, OK, there's like a builder who's actually building these like very valuable blocks. There's the proposer, who's actually the consensus entity. They're the one who needs to actually like sign off that this block should go into the chain. And You know, I'm not going to have a ton of time to get into the details of this, but essentially the way to think about it is that the builder makes a block. It's blinded. That's what this sort of opaque rectangle is meant to communicate. So first they have to say, hey, proposer, here's the block. The proposer says, OK, here's my execution payload that has the MEV. I can't really see what's in it, but it probably seems OK. I'll put it into my consensus block, which is this blue square. They have to give that back then to the builder as a commitment to actually include this particular payload. Then if the builder says that it's all good, it will return that back to the proposer in this unblinded fashion. And the reason you have to do this is because otherwise the proposer could essentially just steal the MEV, right? So the builder puts all this work into making this nice block. There's this MEV attached, which is this like yellow little square there. And you know, we want Ethereum to be the system where anyone can participate as a proposer. So that means that for like a relatively small deposit, you could say, you know, steal this like 100 ETH liquidation from the builder. So we put this commit reveal game, and that's what we see with this like flow here. And yeah, I won't have time to like go into MevBoost further. I just wanted to call out this talk here. Steph will be talking from Flashbots. We'll be talking about MevBoost and sort of what the future holds there. But this talk will not be about PBS. It will be about this builder role in particular. So there's a lot going on here. And one way to think about this is now like this like, you know, sort of subspace of MEV within crypto is like professionalizing. And what that means is there's now like these different actors. They all have specialized roles. And yeah, it should be pretty fun. So on one end, we have, I guess the way to think about this is like, you start with users who are using, you know, using the chain. They want to do something. Like here, for example, they want to make some swap on like Uniswap, trade some like ETH for USDC, or perhaps DAI. Then, you know, they use some software like a wallet to say, okay, from that I'm going to turn that into a transaction. This now goes into the mempool. There's a searcher role that I mentioned. They're the ones who are specialized in saying, oh, this is like this arbitrage opportunity, or oh, this is this liquidation opportunity. Different things like this. They then try to gather transactions into these, they're called bundles, but basically the idea is just like, you know, this like one sort of extraction technique to capture the MEV. That then goes to builders, which we'll look at in the rest of the talk. And then builders have to work with validators in this, you know, in some way. Maybe it's helpful just to call out the, oh, there's a laser pointer. That was pretty cool. It's helpful to call out. So the reason we distinguish between builders and searchers is because searchers are like very specialized within like one type of MEV, and there's like so many different types. This builder then is like making the actual full execution payload, so like the full block, and they have just a different set of concerns. So it's worth discriminating them. And then the question is like, yeah, why do we care about this builder role? Well, it's actually like a bunch of cool things you can do, and that's what I want to spend the rest of my time trying to communicate. A number of things. So one is to be this interface between this whole MEV world and all of the validators, and use that to preserve decentralization of the validator set. It's also like a very fun optimization problem, which hopefully you'll get like a small sense for in a second. And yeah, the builder is now this like a way to think about it is like this almost this like abstraction that we can leverage to do a bunch of cool things, and I'll give you a sense of that. And yeah, then having like a very healthy market for builders themselves as being these like very competitive decentralized sort of sub ecosystem. And again, we want that just to make sure that there's not centralization within the builder part of this stack here. So the first benefit, again, just this interface, this is PBS. And it's really just saying what I said a second ago, it's just going to firewall off all this crazy MEV stuff happening from validators. And we do this so that we can keep things decentralized. You don't want it to be the case that like, you know, one of these like big banks is working with like 70% of the validators, because then, you know, the protocol is really not that helpful at that point. We can also look at this, again, as like a really cool optimization problem. So to give you some sense of it, this is like what the actual building process would be. You have a block here. You know, and let's say there's like T gas in the block. The question now is, I have this mempool, and I want to basically pack this block, right? So I want to put, like, here's maybe three transactions. and I want to put some into the block. So, you know, they each have different gas, like maybe this is a trade, this is like an NFT mint, this is, I don't know, some Uniswap trade, different things. And the way the protocol works is that every block has like only so many gas. So now you have to say, okay, given my block, I have to like pick the transactions that are the most valuable to me, subject to the gas limit, right? So I wanted to call this condition out, just saying that like the sum of them that go into the block have to be less than the block limit. So that's one thing. The other thing, though, is what I said, you know, valuable to me. Let's say I put transactions A and B into here, and that, you know, somehow pays me, let's say, X way. I could put A and C, and that pays me Y way. All other things being equal, I'm probably going to want something where X is greater than Y. Or, you know, I want to identify the blocks that are more valuable. So not only do we have this problem where we have to find, you know, the best transactions from the set that even will fit in the block, we also then have to say, okay, do that subject to the constraint that I want to maximize my revenue. So while all that is happening, we also have this notion of availability in the chain, where to start, you might have multiple heads to build on top of. And the reason this is important, right, is because some of these transactions over here could be valid. Like maybe A is only valid on one head and C is only valid on the other. So not only are you doing this like optimization problem to like craft the block, you may also need to like do it in parallel or, you know, multiple at a time. And then you can like run the fork choice to figure out which one is more likely to become the next head. You can like bias your like resources that way. So again, hopefully the picture I'm trying to paint here is that it just is this like really cool programming problem, honestly. Perhaps only because of how complex it is. And yeah, I'll let you go read Wikipedia. There's a definition up here, but this is a, you know, instance of this general notion of bin packing, where again, it's like, it's exactly what it sounds like. You have a bin, which is the block. You have many different sized things, which are all the transactions and all these other constraints. You now want to like pack this bin, pack this block subject to the constraints. But then also you have this notion that like transactions are coming in real time, right? So there's more things in the mempool. You have this constraint that like maybe the fork choice is changing, maybe attestations are coming in, and so then suddenly, you know, this ratio changes. So anyway, hopefully you find that fun. If you do, you can dig in. Another one of the features I wanted to call out was, again, looking at this builder rule as being an instance of account abstraction. So it's this like abstraction layer that lets us do lots of cool things. You've probably heard this term. If you've been in the space, account abstraction, the notion is that, you know, if I want to send a transaction today, there's like some choices that are made. Like, for example, like using ETH as like the native currency, using ECDSA, which is a particular cryptographic scheme, to like authorize the transaction. Like, there's a bunch of things that are fixed for good reason. But, you know, there's other use cases we might want that would make the system easier to use. And they're like kind of hard to do without some extra steps. And to figure out how to get around this, there's been a lot of research. Smart contract wallets was like one example. There's like these EIPs, 3074, 4337. Basically, the idea is we want to have more flexibility around the types of things that we can do using Ethereum. And yeah, there's a lot that's been said about that. But the thing is that this builder abstraction is like another sort of entry into this line of research. Because if you think about it, this builder is almost this like, especially if you can trust them to do certain things, then they kind of work as this like wrapper around the core protocol to like add these extra features in. And so here's like some examples of these types of features. Long list, I'm sure there's a lot more. One of them is like gas sponsorships. The idea here being that this is essentially like, you know, gas or gasless transactions, meaning someone else pays for the gas. So you could just use the chain. You could like say use Uniswap and not even have to worry about paying for the transaction fee because someone else will do that for you, or pay the transaction fee in some other way. And a builder, someone working with the builder, perhaps a sponsor of your DApp, can take care of that. Another one, like again, custom authorization schemes. So I mentioned rather than having this like one particular cryptographic scheme, you could pick whatever. And again, the builder would kind of handle this as having an abstraction around the chain. Another one is event-triggered transactions. You might have heard of the Ethereum alarm clock. The idea is send this transaction only after some other event has happened. And again, that's very general because it could be a very general thing, but there's all sorts of use cases where this is like really helpful. Another one that's pretty cool, pre-confirmations. So, you know, when you send a transaction on Ethereum today, it's just like out in the mempool and you like hope it gets on-chain eventually. And like it usually kind of does, but sometimes it doesn't. Things get stuck. With a builder, you can basically say, hey, builder, you're going to guarantee that I get into some block, and otherwise, right, the transaction just won't get there. And because this builder is this like concrete abstraction or concrete entity, they can kind of give you this guarantee. If you want to hear more about this, Vitalik gave a talk. There was this SBC conference last week, 2 weeks ago, and he talked a bit about that. Another cool thing, builder cancellations, again, kind of paired with pre-confirmations. The idea is I'm going to send a transaction, and the builder will only include the transaction subject to some conditions. And you know, I could then, before the transaction goes on chain, say, hey, actually, don't do that. Withhold the transaction from the block. And the builder can do this because they're the one making the block. This next one, this is probably a whole talk in and of itself, but essentially the idea is MEV rebates. So what I mean here is, so one type of MEV is like called backrunning, where basically I'm going to make a trade against an AMM. This unbalances the pool. Someone could come in after me and essentially like rebalance the pool. This is the arbitrage. So now there's this extra value just from like the fact that my transaction existed. MEV rebate says, okay, rather than have like the searcher capture this value, maybe they capture some, but they could give the rest back to me. And then you could ask this question for like any type of DApp or different DeFi application. Builders could offer the service. Another one is off-chain MEV smoothing. So MEV smoothing is a notion that like if you look at MEV, it's like very spiky. And this again is not very good because some searchers are gonna be better than others. The volatility basically just like makes the better the better ones even better. And to the extent possible, we want to like keep an equal playing field. So one idea is to basically say, okay, for any MEV that goes on chain, you maybe goes into a pool and then it's smoothed out over time. This is kind of like 1559 with the transaction fee mechanism that we have on Ethereum today, where the transaction fees are, well, they're burned, but they could also have been smoothed. Either way, we have a similar. There are some similar thoughts around doing this with MEV. This last one, well, not the last one, there's a bunch on here. Values-based building. So values-based building, the idea is that the way that I've kind of framed things so far is that this is a revenue maximization problem, or this is my goal, right, is to maximize my revenue. But it doesn't have to be this way. For example, I could say, sure, try to maximize my revenue. However, maybe I don't want people to be front run. Like, I should never be front run, or no one should ever be front run. And so because of that, I can work with a specific builder who says, yeah, this is my policy. We will never include transactions that seem to front run someone else. And again, maybe this isn't the most revenue you could bring in, but there's some other reason that this makes you feel good, and then you could imagine going with this builder over another. There's all sorts of these like MEV protection schemes. One of them is threshold encryption. The idea here is that basically my transactions are private until they've been committed to, and this makes certain types of MEV extraction much harder. So again, builders could offer this. There are some proposals actually even put this on chain one day, and then ahead of time, you could do it off chain. Last one, finally, searcher financial services. And again, this is like saying, okay, many people who capture these MEV opportunities, they do it via like flash loans, for example, because they just identify some ARB, and then maybe if they don't have the capital on hand, but if they did, they could like capture more of the arbitrage opportunity, and builders again could do this as well. So that was a lot. Takeaway, there's a lot that's possible, and it's again this like really cool abstraction that now hopefully we'll see a lot of innovation around in terms of features that people can actually use. Last point to make here, why we care about building is just decentralization. So like we do want to keep track of this part of the space because, you know, assuming things move forward in this way and we have this like PBS world where now there is this like MEV sort of industry that's happening, we don't want to get into the place where there's like maybe, you know, three or four like really popular or powerful, let's say, builders. And that's like the only way to get on chain. So we want to avoid builder centralization just in the same way we want to avoid validator centralization. And yeah, again, I think in general, this is still like a very open sort of research space. Vitalik gave a talk, again, I'll mention him, a talk at SBC, this conference I mentioned, and he talked about some of this. And again, the idea is like basically any points in the stack here. Let me go back. Our handy supply chain diagram. You know, all of these things, like order flow all the way to the builder itself could be decentralized. There's, again, a lot of different options here, but the point is that to the extent possible, we want there to be like healthy competition at each stage, not just like a few sort of key actors that are gaining access, you know, to the chain. Okay, I am a little out of time, so just really quickly, here's like some cool things. If this is interesting to you, I'd look at like CalSwap, Rook, used to be called KeeperDAO. Anoma is this interesting project with this notion of like intent-centric design. Basically, it's just taking like all these different things people are doing and saying, okay, like where is this heading? And the point is that rather than have like these like specific things that we try to do, you can imagine there's essentially this whole aggregation layer around like the whole protocol that is you know, facilitating all the stages again here. I should have kept this closer. All these different stages, but then hopefully now with the you know, property that like value doesn't collect in any one place unfairly, like in the sense that like, you know, if I as a user try to use the chain, then like some of, you know, only a little bit of this value of say the arbitrage should go to the searcher, most of it should actually flow back to me. Okay, so I'll just wrap up here. This is me on Twitter. If you want to like chat or anything, like that's a great place. Yeah, there's a few projects here. Something I'm working on is a bunch of MEV tooling in Rust, and I do very much want to like lower the barrier to entry so that we can have this like very competitive ecosystem. So check that out if you're interested. If you want to like more broadly just get involved, there's links here. So there's the Flashbots work under the SmetBoost repo, and some work around these builder specs that we have under the Ethereum repo. So yeah, that's it. And I maybe have one question, maybe not.
Yes, totally time for questions. So.
No questions. Yeah, okay. Thanks, everyone.